All right, so again, my name is Chandan Mehta, and I'm talking about anticoagulation reversal strategies. And who's flipping my slides? I don't, okay.
There you go.
All right, so what? Starting off after lunch, great here. So why do we care? We spend so much time these days talking about door to TPA time, door to needle time, but we also need to care about door to reversal time, because time is ultimately brain, and you know, if we're not killing it off by ischemia, then we're also doing damage by not reversing anticoagulation. So what drugs do we care about? Obviously, this is a very lofty topic to discuss just over a few minutes, so we're just gonna concentrate talking about the old drugs that we're used to seeing in day-to-day practice. Those include warfarin, the unfractionated heparins, low molecular weight heparin, as well as the new drugs, which are most people's concerns these days, which are the DOACs or NOACs, the direct oral anticoagulation agents. And these include the direct thrombin inhibitors, dabigatran, pradaxa, and 10A inhibitors, the apixabans, edoxabans, rivaroxaban. And this is the old coagulation cascade that we all learned back in school. And you can see in the gray where the traditional anticoagulation agents work, and in the pink where the direct oral anticoagulations work, agents work. And I just wanted to kind of tie this all together with a case. And we recently had a case of a 74-year-old gentleman with an aortic valve replacement, which was done over a decade ago. And this gentleman was on warfarin for AFib, and he came into the ER, and his INR was 4.78. And he arrived with a headache. He had seen his PCP 10 days prior. He had had a fall in a hotel. And he just reported feeling off balance subjectively. When he was examined, he was noted to have a normal neuro exam. And so they gave him 2.5 milligrams oral vitamin K, and they transferred him to our ER for evaluation. And you can see on the image there, he's got a moderate-sized hemorrhage in the left cerebellar hemisphere with some surrounding edema. Fast forward to 10 hours later, this gentleman became obtunded. He required intubation, and we sent him for a CT scan. And as you can see, that hemorrhage expanded rapidly and expanded to a very, very large size. His INR at that time was 5.16, and the decision was made at that time to give him four-factor PCC, 35 units per kg. And his INR 37 minutes later was 1.51, and he ended up requiring operative intervention, going to the OR for decompressive craniectomy and EVD placement. So what are our fears with anticoagulation reversal? We have the fear of the known, and that's that somebody has a hemorrhage, and we don't know if it's gonna expand. And the fears of the unknowns, the what ifs, the, oh, you know, this guy has AFib. Are we gonna make him have a thromboembolic event? He's got a valve. Are we gonna thrombose his valve? Are we gonna make him stroke out because of that? And what should be very black and white and very clear takeaway from this talk is that you need to treat the known first. You need to reverse these patients. This guy had a hemorrhage. He's a ticking time bomb when we're waiting for something to happen. So is watchful waiting an option for some patients? The answer is in very, very few circumstances. And we'll kind of get to that. So our common concerns, again, that we said, you know, about mechanical valves, aortic mitral, AFib, and the thromboembolic events related to reversal. And you know, going through lots of retrospective studies, the number of thromboembolic events in reversing these patients is significantly decreased as compared to what we normally expect them to be. So study reviews showed within like a 3-week period post these patients being reversed, the number percentage of events was 0.6 to 0.7%. So the risk is significantly lower than you know what we've been taught in medical school and what we've been taught in pharmacy school. So the answer is to reverse these patients. So your standardized approach should be getting a history from a reliable historian. A lot of our patients come in through the ER, they're very obtunded, or you know they're at a LTAC or nursing facility. So get a history from nursing staff when they were last seen normal or from you know family member. You need to get stat labs, including obviously a coagulation profile. You need to know their creatinine. You need to know their liver function. You need a timeline of events. Medications, the time administered is very important, especially for the DOACs and NOACs. You need to know the last dose. And if a patient comes in and they've recently ingested, obviously, one of the oral medications, activated charcoal, 50 grams, is indicated for administration with if they've taken their med within 2 hours. So looking at the trends in the community between 2013 and 2016, what are other people doing? What are other hospitals doing? And this was looking at a phase 2 outcome registry for better informed treatment of AFib. And they screened over 13,000 patients, 9,967 were included. And there were only 273 events of hemorrhage on NOACs and 71 events on warfarin. And small amounts of intracranial bleeds as well as GI bleeds. But what was commonly seen was that blood products and correction agents were less often used in NOAC patients compared with warfarin-treated patients. And that was 53 versus 76% for blood products, and zero, actually, versus 1.5% for recombinant factor PCC products. So what should you do? Who needs reversal? So any patient that comes into the ER, and if they're on a vitamin K antagonist agent, so obviously warfarin, if they've got an INR greater than 2, if they've got a neurologic deficit and a hemorrhage on the skin, they should be reversed. Again, what time was the last dose? So this is obviously relevant for patients on Coumadin, but mostly applying to the DOACs, where you might not have the ability to determine, you know, by coagulation profile when their last medication was given. Where is the hemorrhage? Posterior fossa, like the case I showed you, any small amount of blood there is very, very relevant and should not, you should not pause and think and wait and see kind of what happens, because you don't have space there to be making decisions later. If they bleed, they can easily herniate and die. And additionally, do these patients have any overlapping renal or hepatic disease or comorbidities which could prolong anticoagulation effects? We've seen cases prior where we've got patients coming in who were undertaking very minor surgical interventions, but they had renal dysfunction, and surgeons didn't necessarily, or maybe they were unaware, or they didn't consider the fact that the 10A effect could have been prolonged in the patient's system, and they ended up bleeding because of renal dysfunction. So a quick drug review. So we've got dabigatran, and this is a selective reversible direct thrombin inhibitor, and it has its peak concentration in the bloodstream within 2 to 3 hours post-ingestion, and half-life is 7 to 17 hours. As you can see, when your creatinine clearance drops, you have a significantly prolonged effect. So reversal, so since 2015, Praxibind is a humanized monoclonal antibody fragment that binds to dabigatran, and it's administered in 2.5 gram doses for a dose of 5 grams total IV. And the full cohort analysis, which just recently came out this past August, demonstrated that in 503 patients, the median maximum percentage of reversal time was 100%. These patients all were reversed. It took about 2.5 hours for the bleeding to essentially stop, and many hospitals still don't have access to this. So because it's not very highly protein bound, you can actually dialyze the dabigatran out if emergently needed. So in regards to the 10A inhibitors, the rivaroxaban, apixaban, and edoxaban, these are again selective reversible 10A inhibitors. The half-life of rivaroxaban is 3 to 9 hours, and the half-life of apixaban is 8 to 15 hours. And these are almost all always protein bound, so you cannot dialyze these out. So the current trial that we are running at Henry Ford, and I know a few hospitals in the area are also participating in, is the Anexa 4 phase 3 trial. And this is looking at competitively binding 10A inhibitors with high affinity. This drug's high affinity for it. And this stops bleeding essentially within 5 minutes. And the study is being run on patients with GI bleeds or life-threatening bleeds, including intracranial hemorrhage, with the last dose of medication within 18 hours. And it's a bolus and an infusion. The bolus takes a very short period of time, and you can have effect for up to 2 hours post-bolus of anticoagulation reversal. And then you've got a 1 to 2 hour infusion with 2 hours of effect post-infusion. And if this is unavailable and not a running study at your institution, four-factor PCC can be administered to temporize bleeding effects. So in terms of the most common thing that drug that we see patients still coming in on, warfarin, this obviously inhibits vitamin K-dependent carboxylation of multiple blood factors. And so we advise that vitamin K, 10 milligrams, should be administered along with four-factor PCC. And four-factor PCC is preferred over FFP due to short time of administration, very low volume in terms of the drug administration versus FFP. FFP requires many units and requires many hours to deliver the same effect. And four-factor PCC can work in 15 to 30 minutes. So failure to correct INR within 2 hours in comparing patients who had had FFP versus PCC was found to be an independent predictor of death or severe disability in one retrospective cohort. So if patients are noted to still have INR elevations greater than 1.4, 1.5, 6 to 8 hours after, dosing of FFP can be given dependent on the urgency of the situation that you're dealing with the patient, or readministration of four-factor PCC may be considered. So in regards to heparin and low molecular weight heparin reversals, you're going to administer protamine sulfate, and then this is obviously dose dependent depending on when the last dose was given, if it was given greater or less than 8 hours. So adjunctive medications which can be administered, recombinant factor 7A, and this initiates rapid hemostasis. This can be given in emergent operative settings when you're unable to stop bleeding. Four-factor PCC when it's not the solution. I mean, in the past, for dabigatran reversal, four-factor PCC was administered. If you don't have the reversal at your hospital, then you should consider PCC. And patients on dialysis, desmopressin has been indicated to stop bleeding. Tranexamic acid and aminocaproic acid, as well as other blood products, may also be administered. So your takeaway from this should be that when in doubt, reverse patients, don't wait for things to happen, because you know they may not, the patient may not bleed. You know, the patient's subdural may not progress in size, or intracranial hemorrhage may not grow. But the chance of taking that opportunity or that risk to allow them to progress to that is it's a very dangerous situation and not very justifiable when we have appropriate reversal agents, and the risk of thromboembolic events is very low. So. Again, it's a case-by-case analysis, and you need to discuss the risks and benefits with the caregivers. And if a patient's got an LVAD, that's a completely different situation, and cardiology needs to be involved in that decision-making process, because those patients usually should not be.